Good morning, friends. Today we will talk about transmission control protocol. So we are going to talk about what is the role of transmission control protocol in networking. The TCP provides reliable transmission of data in an IP environment. TCP corresponds to the transport layer of OSI model. So that is a fourth layer of our OSI model. That is a transport layer. So in the previous lecture we have studied what is UDP, user datagram protocol. That is also a protocol of a OSI model which works on the fourth layer of a OSI model, which is called as a transport layer. So UDP was a connectionless protocol and TCP is a connection oriented protocol. So let's see the features of TCP, that is transmission control protocol. So the very first one is transmission control protocol is a process to process protocol. That means the TCP uses port number, a transport layer addresses. We have some examples of port number which is used by TCP. For example, we have ECO, that is a port number 7 is used. The ECO is nothing but sends receive datagram back to sender. That is what the role of a ECO signal. Then we have lot of examples such as discard, user, court, telnet, DNS, finger, remote procedure call. So these are the protocols which is used, well known ports used by TCP. So it has different port numbers. So that is the first feature of TCP protocol. Then we have TCP uses port numbers, whereas we have discussed in the last lecture UDP does not uses the port number. That means what? The port number used by the UDP was a software port number, but since TCP is a connection oriented protocol, as you can see in the third point, it is written that it is a connection oriented protocol. That means it will definitely going to use a port, but that is a hardware port. It creates a virtual connection. It creates a virtual connection. So there will be a physical connection. That is why the port number will be of a hardware port number. Whereas in UDP, we do not have a connection. So we don't require to establish a connection. That is a hardware connection, physical connection. That is why we were using a port number, that is a software port numbers, but here we require a hardware port numbers. And then the fourth point is it uses flow and error control mechanism. So what is error and flow control mechanism? So that very well we know what are the different types of error controlling devices we have, what are the different methods to detect and to correct the error. So the error control mechanism is inbuilt for TCP. This allows TCP to provide a reliable service. The error control mechanism considers a segment as the unit of data for error connection. However, the byte oriented error control is provided, where also it controls the flow. So TCP provides flow control, where UDP does not provide a flow control. So just try to see the difference also. What is the difference between UDP and TCP? This will avoid data overflow at the receiver. The TCP uses byte oriented flow control. That is a very important point. It uses a byte flow control. Since it has flow, error and congestion control, that's why TCP is a reliable protocol. Whereas we have discussed in UDP, the UDP was not reliable protocol. Why? The reason was we were sending a lot of packets, that is for the audio, images or video. So for that purpose we required a larger bandwidth, so some of the bandwidth gets lost or wastage. So that is why that was a unreliable protocol, and TCP is a reliable protocol. The reason is we have the error control mechanism, flow control and the congestion control mechanism. We can control the error, we can control the flow and the traffic, that is congestion. That is why TCP is reliable protocol. Now try to understand TCP basics. Means what, why invented, what is the reason behind using this protocol. So it repairs packet losses, which is very important. That is the main advantage of TCP. Safe application from doing it. Now next point is, what does TCP do? What is the role of TCP? So TCP guarantees that all data is delivered in sequence and without loss. Very important. That is the main advantage of TCP, whereas we have discussed UDP. So the delivery of the data was not guaranteed in UDP, but here we have the guarantees of data delivering in sequence without loss of data unless the connection is broken. TCP should work for all applications that transfer data either in small or large quantities. So we can send a small packets also, or we can send a large packet also, where the bandwidth requires are very large. So there are less chances of losing the data. The loss of data is less. TCP does not work with multicast IP address. So we should know what is multicast and what is unicast. So in the previous lectures in the network layer, we have discussed what is unicast and what is multicast IP addresses. So first try to understand what is unicast IP addresses. So unicast IP addresses that identifies a unique node on a network. Unicast address is a reliable, is available in IPv4 and IPv6, typically refers to a single sender or single receiver. Very importantly, unicast is single sender or single receiver, although it can be used in both sending and receiving, but at a time it will send or it will receive, either send or either receive. But in multicast, it is a logical identifier for a group of hosts in a computer network. That are IPv4 multicast addresses are defined by MSB pattern, that is 1110, that means 28. So 2 raised to 28 will be the total number of addresses that can be used in multicast. So single address refers to multiple network devices, that is called the multicast, whereas in UDP it does not do the multicasting. TCP also does flow control and congestion control, as we discussed. That is why it is a reliable protocol. Now the next point comes, next question comes, how does TCP work? So the very first is, we have to establish a connection. Since it is a connection oriented protocol, so the very first, when we talk about the working of TCP, so we have to establish a connection. That means synchronization of sequence number. So we will be assigning a port number. Along with the port number, we will be having a sequence number which is open between two processes. Then TCP implements ARQ methods, that is for error recovery. So in the previous chapters, we have already discussed what are the different types of ARQ methods, automatic repeat request. So we have seen the different types and how the data can be send or acknowledge can be received, we have seen in the ARQ methods. So here also we can use such techniques or methodology to recover the error or to control the flow by using this methodology. So this is how TCP work. Now the next very important point is TCP services. So what are the services provided by the transmission control protocol? So the very first is stream delivery service. What do you mean by this? So TCP is a stream oriented protocol. The sending process delivers data in the form of a stream of bytes, and the receiving process receives it in the same manner. So the sender will send a delivery in the form of a stream of bytes. The TCP creates a working environment in such a way that the sending and the receiving processes seem to be connected by an imaginary cube. Like when we talk about the stream of delivery, so from the host, one host to the another host, sender to the receiver, it will seem like a tube. So that from that tube, the stream of byte will be transmitted. So that is why the name given as stream delivery service. The second service provided by the TCP is sending and receiving buffers. What do you mean by this? So the sending and receiving processes may not produce and receive data at the same speed. Hence, TCP needs buffer for storage of data at both the ends. There are two types of buffer used in each direction. One is a sending buffer, another is called as a receiving buffer. A buffer can be implemented by using a circular array of 1 byte location. The directional of movement of data, the sending buffer has three type location. One is the empty location, second is a locations containing the bytes, third is a location containing the byte to send by the sending TCP. So this is how we have to manage the sending and the receiving buffer to match the speed, that is flow of data or a packet in TCP protocol, using TCP protocol. Then you can see a stream of byte is accepted for transmission and deliver at destination that we discussed just now. TCP uses port numbers like UDP. For example, TCP port 80 is used for web servers. So as we discussed, we have the different port numbers which is reserved for the different applications, like port 80 is reserved for the or used for the web server. TCP requires that a connection is open before data can be transmitted. So as we know that it is a connection oriented, we have to establish a connection. So connection is open before the data can be transferred. So that is a transparency. A TCP connection is identified by source IP address, source port. So we have the source port, that is a physical port or a hardware port, where we will be assigning a port number. Using that port number, we will assign an IP address. Similarly, for the destination, we have the destination port number, destination IP address. Then the seventh point, you can see the service provided by the TCP is reliable service. TCP is a reliable transport protocol and not unreliable like UDP, as we discussed. Different acknowledgements are used by the receiver to convey sender the status of data. Very important point. Then the next one is full duplex service. TCP offers full duplex service where the data can flow in both the directions simultaneously. That is why it is full duplex. Each TCP will then have a sending buffer and receiving buffer. The TCP segments can travel in both the directions. Therefore, TCP provides a full duplex service. So these are the services. Next very important topic is TCP uses connections. So as we all know that we have to establish a connection, so we have to assign a sequence number. So that is the first step. To establish a connection, we have to assign a sequence number. Then we have the frame format of TCP. Very important frame format of TCP, which consists of source port, destination port, sequence number, acknowledgement number, checksum, urgent pointer, padding, etc. So now see, this is the complete frame format of TCP, where we have the different terminologies. You have to just try to understand. URG, that is urgent pointer, is valid. ACK, that is acknowledgement field, is valid. PSH, that is push request, is send. Reset the connection, sync the connection setup. FNS, sender has reached end of byte stream. So first try to understand this. Now we have, the first is called as a source port. A 16-bit number identifying the application, the TCP segment originated from within the sending host. The port number are divided three ranges. Well-known port 0 through 1023. So the total number of the size of the data bytes are 65495. That is the total size, out of which it is divided into three ranges. First is well-known port, that is 0 through 1023. Then we have registered port, where what is 1024 through 49151, and private ports 49152 through 65535. So these are the port assignments are used by TCP as an interface to the application layer, because the uppermost layer of a physical layer is nothing, OSI model is nothing but a application layer. So that will be interfaced through these ports. Then we have the destination port, which is also of 16 bit, identifying the application. The TCP segment is desired destined for on a receiving host. Destination ports use the same port number assignment as those set aside for the source port. So for the source port and the destination port, the assigning ports are numbers are same. Then we have, you can see here, sequence number, a 32 bit number identifying the current position of the first data byte. So in the sequence number will be having a position of the first data byte in the segment within the entire byte stream for the TCP connection. So after reaching 2^32 - 1, this number will be the wrap around to 0. So this is what we call it as a sequence number. Then we have acknowledgement number. As you can see, the third layer of this frame, acknowledgement number. So what is acknowledgement number? Again, acknowledgement number is of 32 bit identifying the next data byte the sender expects from the receiver. So receiver, the sender will expect a next data byte from the receiver, therefore the number will be 1 greater than the most recently received data byte. This field is only used when this acknowledgement control bits is turned on. Until unless we won't receive an acknowledgement from the receiver, so this bit will not give the next data byte. That is what we call it as an acknowledgement number. Then we have header length, which is of 4 bit. Alright, then we have reserve bit, that is a 6 bit, currently unused, reserved for future use. Then we have flags, that is called as a control bit. So in that flags, we have different types of flag. One is called as synchronize, push function, acknowledgement, urgent pointer. So what is urgent pointer? So here you can see checksum and urgent pointer. So the urgent pointer is, in certain circumstances it may be necessary for a TCP sender to notify the receiver of urgent data that should be processed by the receiving application as soon as possible. The 16 bit field tells the receiver when the last byte of urgent data in the segment ends. So this is what we call it as an urgent pointer. Then we have option, if any. So here you can see the option, if any, that means in order to provide additionally functionality, several optional parameters may be used between a TCP sender and receiver. Depending on the options used, the length of the field will vary in size, but it cannot be larger than 40 bytes. So the maximum larger size is of 40 bytes. Due to the size of the header length field, the header length field is of 4 bits. The most common option is the maximum segment size option. A TCP receiver tells the TCP sender the maximum segment size it is willing to accept through the use of this option. So other options are often used for various flow control and congestion control technique. So this is what we call it as a option. Then where you can see the padding, so because option may vary in size, so it may necessary to pad the TCP header with zeros. So extra padding bits will require because the size can be vary. Yes, so that is why additionally functionality bits are providing. So for that we required extra bits to be added. So that is called as a padding. So the TCP header with zeros, so we pad with the zeros so that the segment ends on a 32 bit word boundary as defined by the standard. So the total size will be of 32 bit. Then we have segment data, that is the last one, which is a MSS byte. Okay, maximum segment size, that is the segment data, although not used in some circumstances. For example, acknowledgement segments with no data in the reverse direction. This variable length field carries the application data from TCP sender to receiver. This field coupled with the TCP header fields constitutes a TCP segment. So this is what we call it as a entire frame format, where the checksum is nothing but we apply different methods to detect or to correct the error. So that is what we call it as a checksum. So this is the entire frame format of TCP. So we discuss in the today's lecture what is the role of a TCP, what are the in which layer it works of our OSI model. Then we have differentiate what is UDP and TCP, what is the basic difference between UDP, user datagram protocol, and TCP, that is transmission control protocol. So TCP is a connection oriented protocol. It is a process to process communication protocol. It uses establish a connection. It is a reliable protocol. So this is what we can conclude from the lecture. If you have any queries, any doubts, you can contact me, you can WhatsApp me. The link is given, the contact number, the email ID is given on the link. You just go through it, subscribe on the YouTube and contact, try to understand. All the best. Thank you.